Okay. As always, folks, we're trying to the things that we're looking at, folks, in terms of health. We always talk about a focused, happy mind. The profiles of a healthy person include a regular diets and the things, of course, that we know about. But we want to go a little deeper than that. We want to expand the options, and you see these on our websites. How the body works, of course, is the most important thing. The more we understand how our bodies work, the easier it will be for us to give our bodies what they need, the easier it will be for us to maintain good posture, alignment, balance. The easier it will be for us to avoid threats, the easier it will be for us to deal with health challenges when they occur, the easier it will be for us to overcome physical trauma and reduce wear and tear, and really the easier it will be for us to understand and work with our doctors. But as I was looking through Dr. John's presentation and his slides, and he has a lot of very, very interesting slides to show us, as I was looking through all that, I realized that what he's going to be talking about basically covers all seven of these factors. All seven. And so I'm extremely excited to have him on to speak to us about innovations in wound care and wound healing. And again, it goes beyond just the question of wound care and wound healing. And I fear that some people have decided not to join this webinar because they just thought it was going to be restricted to wounds. So, but anyway, good thing is that we have these calls recorded. So, without much further ado, I'm going to hand over the screen to you, Dr. John. And while you're getting ready, I'm just going to read out your bio. So, if you would accept the screen sharing, and I'm just going to pull up your bio and read it out. Dr. John, I think there's something kind of like there's some background noise there. So maybe sheets of paper being shuffled around. So just so you'll be aware of that. All right. John E. Hall, DDS, graduated from Baylor College of Dentistry in 1978 and practiced general dentistry in Arlington, Texas for 8 years. After retiring from dental practice, he worked in the R&D department of Carrington Labs, Inc., in Irving, Texas for 8 years. Dr. Hall was involved in the development and performance of investigational programs involving both preclinical and clinical trials. As director of clinical trials, he developed and oversaw studies, phases 1 to 3, in ulcerative colitis and AIDS, as well as studies involving various intraoral conditions. Dr. Hall helped develop several products and is listed as a co-inventor on two patents for intraoral care, wound care products. He has served as a consultant to pharmaceutical and dietary supplement companies with emphasis on clinical program development and regulatory affairs. He is co-author of 6 papers published in medical and dental journals. And so, with a great deal of gratitude, Dr. Hall, are you there?
Yes, I am.
All right, well, thank you again for agreeing to do this webinar and actually to spend all the time preparing for it. I know you've put a lot into this, so thank you, and I'm just going to hand it over to you.
Okay, David, thanks a lot for inviting me to present tonight. I appreciate the opportunity, and it's really kind of gratifying to know that there's somebody else out there that has as much trouble with some of this technology as I do, so I don't feel quite as lonely now, so there's at least two of us anyway.
There you go. Absolutely.
And also, just to mention, just today we got our journal in the. I have sent a journal that or article that I published that just came out in General Dentistry today. It's the Journal of the Academy of General Dentistry.
Oh,
And
great, great.
so that just came out today. So, and that was actually we'll see a slide that refers to that article in a little while. But anyway, thanks for inviting me to speak. And I must say, this is the first time that I've ever given a presentation to a computer monitor. So this is really different. But I'll do the best I can. I want to talk about wound healing and wound management. And you'll notice on this first slide, advancing the science of wound care is what we try to be about with our company, McFarland Dental Products. And we'll talk about. I want to just brush over some. Oops. That's not, suddenly that's not, there we go. And we want to talk about the wound healing process and just really lightly touch on that and then move on to other issues in wound care, really. And then and we'll talk about the product and some of the products we've developed and the rationale and the theory behind their development. So let's just talk real quickly about wound healing and just rush over that kind of quickly and make some salient points, though, and then move on to wound care. Most authors divide wound healing into four phases, although there are a few that combine the first two phases. I don't like that. To me, hemostasis and inflammation are different. So there's four phases of wound healing, and we'll just touch briefly on each of those. The first is hemostasis, and as you know, that yes, that refers to the body's ability. Thank you. Thank you, Eric. Eric's leaving. He's the one who helped get me online, so he's out of here.
Okay. Yeah, you're on your own now, huh?
Yeah, I'm on by myself now. Hemostasis is the body's attempts and ability to control bleeding. And we'll talk about some of the cell types that are involved in each of these phases. Platelets, of course, are not really cells. They're cell fragments of megakaryocytes, but for tonight's discussion, we'll refer to platelets as the cell type of hemostasis. And, of course, they're in the circulation, and when injury occurs and blood is spilled out into the tissues, platelets come in contact with extravascular collagen. That stimulates them to release alpha granules, which cause several things to occur. The first thing is the platelets actually become sticky. They start to stick to each other, and they become clumps of platelets and the great balls of platelets, and they actually start sticking to the tissues, and so they mechanically occlude holes that are in the vasculature and help mechanically to slow the bleeding down. Alpha granules also release other chemicals that promote migration of other cells that are involved in wound healing. These four components of the clotting cascade, although they also are partially involved in the wound healing process. But the first thing that we try to do is get a clot formed and to stop the bleeding. And so down here you see they become sticky and they aggregate. These alpha granules also produce other cytokines and growth factors, as we see here, that are involved in recruiting and activating cells that are involved in the rest of the healing process. So the first thing is get the bleeding under control, but immediately we start secreting cells or chemicals that start the healing process. The next phase is inflammation. And everybody pretty much understands the hallmarks of inflammation. You have erythema or the redness and the fever, the higher temperature in the area of injury, and then the swelling or edema. And then pain, which is important to let us know that injury has occurred. And the four words on the left are the Latin terms that all doctors learn for those words. But those are the hallmarks of inflammation. And not all of them have to take place, but most of the time all four of those take place during inflammation. They're all due to mast cell release of enzymes and histamines and other chemicals that cause these conditions. And one of the dogmas of wound care is that inflammation is necessary for wound healing. If inflammation doesn't occur, by and large, wound healing doesn't occur. So we tend to think of inflammation as bad, but inflammation is good and is necessary for wound healing. Okay, wound inflammation usually begins within 24 hours and lasts up to 2 weeks or so. And the cell type of inflammation, the first responder is a neutrophil. Now, I type PMN, which is polymorphonucleoside. PMN is quicker to type, but neutrophil rolls off the tongue quicker and easier. So I'll use the term neutrophil, but it's the same cell. And these are white blood cells that are phagocytes. They actually ingest and kill microbes. They also ingest foreign material and damaged tissue and clean up the area to help prepare it for wound healing. They also secrete cytokines such as interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor alpha, which are pro-inflammatory cytokines that help recruit and activate other cells to continue with the healing process. But neutrophils come in very quickly after injury, and they start killing microbes and thinning up the area. This is a photomicrograph of a neutrophil, and you can see why it's called a polymorphonuclear. So that's one nucleus, the purple area, but it looks like three different nuclei, but that's one nucleus, and that's the reason they're called polymorphonucleocytes. You can see they're about the size of two or three red blood cells, so they're not very big. Okay, and then right after the neutrophils come in, the monocytes and macrophages come in. Monocyte And macrophages are really the same cell. When they're in the circulation, they're called monocytes. When they come out into the tissue, they differentiate and perform the functions of macrophages. So we're talking about the same cell, really. A macrophage is a large cell. It's a large phagocyte. So it continues with phagocytizing microbes and debris and helping to prevent infection and clean up the area. But they also secrete cytokines that are important in the wound healing process. And macrophages are second to none in the amount of cytokines they secrete. I know 20 years ago when I started with this, there were about 100 different secretions that had been identified. I think we're up to about 200 now, if I'm right. So they secrete lots of different kinds of cytokines, and they stimulate and different cells to do what they do, as you can see here. And I'm not going to get into all this information too deeply. I just wanted to show you some of this. And these are just a few of the secretions that macrophages have produced. And you may have noticed, these are some of the same that neutrophils and that platelets secrete. So there's a lot of overlap in the function and secretions of all these cells. Okay, the macrophage is the single most important cell in wound healing. It is the Arturo Toscanini of the wound healing symphony. And the dogma is no macrophage, just like inflammation, no macrophage, no healing. Almost everybody agrees that they're necessary for healing. There are one or two authors that aren't sure about that, but everybody agrees that they're necessary for normal wound healing. And really, I think, basically, if you don't have macrophages, you're not going to have healing. So macrophages are extremely important. And this is a photomicrograph of a macrophage that has phagocytized many bacteria. You can see different bacteria and fragments of bacteria. Okay, we already mentioned that some of these cytokines recruit these cells like macrophages. So they're recruited by some of the secretions from neutrophils and platelets, but there are other conditions that help recruit macrophages to the wound area. A slightly low pH, so it's just, 4, 5, 6, slightly acidic pH, and slight hypoxia, so a slight low oxygen tension to the area helps recruit macrophages. And then there are other things that activate macrophages, and we're going to talk about mannans quite a bit later on, but polysaccharides, which are sugars, and specifically mannans, are real potent activators of macrophage activity, so we wanted to mention that, and we will certainly talk about mannans later on. Okay, proliferation is the third phase of wound healing. It starts around day 4, thereabouts, lasts for 10 days or so. And the three main things they do, early on there was the clot and then there was a provisional matrix, and now we need to replace that provisional matrix with a matrix more suitable for the remainder of the healing process, which has a lot of collagen and proteoglycans and glycoproteins too. So proteoglycan is a sugar with proteins attached to it, and the glycoproteins are proteins with sugars attached to them. Basically the same type of thing, it's just the ratio of sugar to protein. Angiogenesis and epithelialization. Angiogenesis is another term for neovascularization or growth of new blood vessels. And epithelialization is just what it says, it's the growth of the epithelial tissues, the epidermis, the cells of the epidermis. And angiogenesis is and granulation tissue and I've always given this presentation to dentists and I've won, like I said, 2 or 3 EMDs before, but everybody, these people understand what granulation tissue is. It's just the body throws in a bunch of collagen and other things, and then it grows as quickly as it can new blood vessels, and it's very easy for this tissue to bleed. And the way that works is endothelial cells, which are cells that line the inside lining of blood vessels, migrate. They're next to the injury, they migrate and they actually they send buds into the matrix and they meet with other buds, come from the other direction, and they form capillaries that way. Matrix formation, the new matrix formation, fibroblasts is a cell involved in that. We usually think of collagen, which is a protein, when we think of fibroblasts, but they also produce elastins, which is another type of protein, and proteoglycans, which again are sugars with proteins attached to them. Okay, for epithelialization, that's the job of the keratinocyte, which is the cell of the epithelium. It's the live keratinocytes are in the along the basal layer of the epithelium, and they have to disconnect. They have to secrete enzymes that dissolve the hemidesmosomes and the desmosomes, and so that they can actually migrate. So the keratinocytes separate themselves from each other and from the tissue, and then they actually migrate across the wound surface. And when a single layer of keratinocytes covers the wound bed, they stop migrating, and they start stratifying, and they develop the stratified squamous epithelium that we all know and love as the epidermis of our skin and of the mucosa in the mouth, for example. And I also want to talk a little bit about T cells. These are lymphocytes that are in wounds, and we didn't know for a long time what they had to do specifically with injury or with wound healing, except for helping to prevent infection. But it is now known that there are different types of T cells, and the CD8 cells and CD4 cells. CD4 cells means something to a lot of people now because they're aware of CD4 cells, the type of lymphocytes that HIV invades and attacks. So AIDS and HIV disease, the general public heard of CD4 cells or T4 cells, but it's the ratio of CD4 cells to CD8 cells that helps to regulate the proliferative phase also. So they secrete various interleukins and other kinds of cytokines to help with that. So they're involved not only in just preventing preventing infection, but also helping with the healing process. Remodeling is the fourth phase, and this may continue for a long time. And people are, everybody understands that you have an injury and you have a scar, and over the years you'll notice that scar is a little less noticeable, and that's because it's always being remodeled, and we're changing the type of collagen to a type 1 collagen, which is more organized, has greater tensile strength. But so the older scars are a little stronger. They don't tear as easily as the newer scars with the type 3 collagen. But this is the fourth phase, and it can go on for a long time. Being a dentist, I also throw this slide in because I'm usually talking to dentists. And so alveolar bone is the bone of the jaw that teeth are in. And when teeth are extracted or luxated and lost, there are still some periodontal ligament fibers that are in the socket. And periodontal ligament or periodontal membrane is the tissue that surrounds the tooth that helps connect the tooth to the jaw. These are important to take care of because many of these act as stem cells, and they actually can differentiate into fibroblasts, which produce fibrous connective tissue. That's not surprising. But what may be surprising some, they also can differentiate into osteoblasts that help develop bone tissue. So the periodontal ligament cells are important to take care of. And we aren't always good about doing that at dentistry, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. Okay, I just want to review the cells of wound healing, and so we've talked a lot about these. The thing I really want you to understand is that every one of these cells is important. And anything we do to damage or kill any one of these cells is going to slow the healing process down. So we need to try to take care of these cells. The problem is about 110% of the time when we're treating wounds, we're damaging these cells. Usually when we treat wounds, we're either trying to prevent infection or we're treating an infection. And I'll show you data later on in the presentation, show you how tenuous this is. But almost always we're damaging these cells. And so when we're treating wounds, we're almost always slowing the healing process down. The other thing is that anything that harms any one of these cells harms all of them. It's kind of the all or none law. So they're all almost equally susceptible to various chemicals and treatments. So that's something else we'll talk about. Okay, let's go into wound care. And right now, wound management, and now generally talking about external, not intraoral, but just general wound of the skin, we usually deal with pain, and we try to prevent or treat infection, and we use wound dressings. And wound dressings are very important. What are the functions of wound dressings? They cover and protect the wound. That's pretty obvious. By so doing, they also help prevent microbial infection. But another thing they do is they help to maintain optimal moisture. And which leads me to this slide. Of course, maybe some of the younger people may not know who this is, but this is Sir Winston Churchill. And one of my favorite stories of Winston Churchill is he gave a speech one time during which he evidently ended the sentence with a preposition, and somebody in the audience took umbrage to that and wrote a note being a chicken, evidently, he wrote a note. He wouldn't go up top, but he gave the note to a friend, and then after the speech, the friend took the note up to Winston Churchill, and he read the note. He turned the note over. He wrote, took a pen out, wrote on the back, and sent it back, and he wrote, "This is the type of nonsense up with which I will not put." Well, that's a cute story, but the story when I first read it was that in the English language, sometimes it just works better to end a sentence with a preposition. It breaks the rule, but sometimes, as in his example, it just doesn't roll off the tongue very well, and it sounds silly. So sometimes rules need to be broken.
Right.
And sometimes some rules don't have any reason for existing at all, which leads me to this slide. Moist wounds. Maintaining optimal moisture in the wound is one of the most significant advancements of wound treatment since sterile techniques and materials were championed by Semmelweis and Pasteur. The reason I say this is because people my age, I'm 58, so you know, I've been around a while, but not that we were necessarily taught this, and you know, as you know, dental school and medical school were really not taught much about treating wounds. It's one of those things that's kind of overlooked usually, but just growing up, it was generally understood that wounds should be kept dry. Why? Because you don't want to get them infected. They get wet, they get infected.
Mm-hmm.
Well, every study has shown that that's not true, and we can go to a little of the history. In 1948, I'm not sure how, but Oscar, in 1948, just using adhesive tape showed that just covering up the ulcer, a venous ulcer with adhesive tape healed faster, and it was a function of helping the wounds keep moist. Well, it didn't have the technology to do much about it, so nothing much happened. 14 years later, George Winter, and this is a big name in wound care history, in 1962, he published in Nature a study where he studied partial thickness wounds in pigs and showed that if you kept the wounds moist, there was a 50% increase in the epithelialization rate. Well, that's significant. Maybach, a year later in Nature, published his work based on Winter's work, although he did it in humans, it included wounds, and he's got the same thing, about a 50% increase in epithelialization rate. So every well-designed and well-conducted study has shown since then that wounds that are kept moist heal faster with fewer infections. And as I throw this in about Galen of Pergamum, better known to most of us as just Galen or Galen the physician, but in the second century, he was given the task by the emperor of Rome, by Caesar, to treat his gladiators. And so this was a real important job, and he knew his neck was on the line. But he actually discovered and documented that wounds that were kept moist healed faster with fewer infections. And for the next 1600 years, it was generally understood that wounds should be kept moist because Galen said they should be kept moist. And then what happened was that around the mid-1800s, we discovered bacteria and fungi and all this. And we hadn't quite come up with viruses yet, but we discovered bacteria. And then we came up with the germ theory of disease. And then we realized that bacteria and fungi grow best in what? They grow best in warm, dark, moist environments. Holy cow, what have we been doing? We've been treating these wounds, keeping them moist. All we've been doing is causing infection. We've got to keep them dry, open to the air. And so for the next 100-150 years, and even until now, because when I give this presentation, I ask for people, and I get about half the people that they nod, yes, that they've understood you're supposed to keep wounds dry.
Right. Me too.
But anyway, the point is that they don't. Every study has shown that wounds that are kept dry, you're going to have more infections, you're going to slow the healing process down. And when you think about it, what's happening is that you're killing all the cells involved in wound healing. You might be killing some of the bacteria, but if they're open to the air, you're getting constantly bombarded with doses of bacteria and fungi, and you're killing your own cells, so the balance is tilted in favor of the pathogen, so you're going to have more infections, and it's going to slow the healing process down. And so wounds ideally should be kept moist, period. That's the end of the story. That's dogma now. And yet a big percentage of physicians and dentists don't know that yet. And obviously that knowledge has been around for a long time, or the data have been around for a long time. Okay, as you'll notice on these, I'm going to kind of bounce from one thing to the other, but we got a lot to cover. Let's look at some ancient wound management. This is interesting, I think. 3000 B.C., Egyptians were using, I mean, they did a lot of silly things and really horrible things, but one of the things they did right is they took honey and animal fat, mixed it together, wrapped it in linen, and covered that and used that as a dressing on wounds. They also used aloe vera. Alexander the Great was said to have carried wagon loads of live aloe vera plants, he called it the potted physician, into battle because they had found that his soldiers that were treated with fresh aloe vera gel, their wounds healed faster, they had fewer infections, they had fewer soldiers dying from these infections, and so he wouldn't go into battle without aloe vera if he could help it. Worldwide, tree guns have been used for thousands of years as wound dressings. And as obviously, it's been known for a long time that wounds should be dressed, too, so that's an interesting thing. Well, is there a common denominator we can see here? Okay, honey, sugar, aloe vera. What's the active ingredient in aloe vera? We'll talk about that. You mentioned Bill McAnally, who will be speaking, I think you said, next week.
Yes.
And with whom I've worked for 20 years. He is the guy who identified the active ingredient in aloe vera almost 30 years ago now. Everybody was looking for a steroid or a protein, and he was too at first, but it turned out that he discovered it was a sugar. It was a beta-linked polysaccharide. It's acetylated mannan. It's ace mannan. And so it's a sugar. So honey, sugar, aloe vera, sugar, and then tree gums. What are gums? They're complex polysaccharides. Maybe some proteins mixed in, but by and large, they're complex sugars. So the common denominator is a lot of these things that had sugar in them. Okay, and we'll get back to that later on. Okay, now let's get into some issues that we need to talk about with current therapy. Allergies. That's a big deal. Thimerosal. If you wear contact lenses like I do, then most people know that the contact lens solutions, they still use thimerosal as a preservative in contact lens solutions. I think about 70% of contact lens wearers are now allergic to thimerosal. And old-timers like I am remember methylate. And when you had a sore throat, your mom would swab your throat with methylate. And, you know, I don't know if it was that helping or just the threat of doing it a second time, you were suddenly going to feel better. Because it was nasty stuff. Well, it was a recipient of the prestigious Allergen of the Year Award in 2002, awarded by the North American Contact Dermatitis Group. It's a real problem with allergies. Okay, bacitracin. Everybody's heard of bacitracin. It's one of the active ingredients in Neosporin, Polysporin. You see a Neosporin ad almost every day on TV. Didn't used to be a problem, but nurses here were using it. Were the first to start coming up with allergies, and now it's a horrible allergen, and it won the 2003 Allergen of the Year Award.
Hmm.
And now we'll get into this a little bit later too, but now Dr. McAnally's son, Shane, finished medical school last year, and he told us that at their med school anyway, that the dermatology service, they basically just use Vaseline anymore to treat wounds because they've been forced into it because everybody is allergic to just about everything they try anymore.
Right.
So allergy is becoming a real problem. Okay, well, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, too. Okay, preservatives. Okay, products that are used like treating wounds, they either have to be sterile or they're preserved. By federal law, you have to have preservatives in a non-sterile, multi-use product. Preservatives do two things. One thing is they help stabilize, their types of preservatives stabilize the chemistry, so the chemicals, so that they don't break down. But the really important thing, too, is that there are preservatives that prevent contamination. They kill the microbes, and they prevent contamination and subsequent infection after use of a certain product. So you have to have preservatives in these types of products by law. The problem is about 100% of the time, companies use synthetic compounds, which are biocides, as preservatives. Well, what's the problem with biocides? We'll look at the word bio, life, side, kill. These are indiscriminate killers, and we'll see data to show that. They basically kill everything, which is a real problem when you're trying to treat wounds. Okay, chlorhexidine. Chlorhexidine is an antiseptic, but it also is used as a preservative in some intraoral products. It's not real good against fungi, but it eventually kills some, but it works pretty well against bacteria. And there are others, like parabens, and dentists and physicians know that the parabens are used as a preservative in our anesthetic agents, but also in other products. They're pretty good against fungi, not real good against gram-negatives, problem for intraoral use is they're inactive about pH of 6. Well, the mouth is a pH of 7, so that rules them out. And so we have some issues with preservatives. Okay, antiseptics. You know, I mentioned that we usually, when we're treating wounds, we're treating them with antiseptics. Well, sodium hypochlorite is the active ingredient in bleach, in Clorox bleach. 0.5% is used as a skin cleanser. It takes 30 minutes of continuous contact to kill some of these two bacterial species, and Candida albicans is a fungal species. It's a yeast-like fungus. 4% is almost 80% Clorox, and that it takes 5 minutes to kill those. So, I mean, there, you know, it works, but it's not super active. But the problem is 0.025% is toxic to periodontal ligament cells. Remember I said we really need to take care of periodontal ligament cells because they help to grow the bone back after a tooth is lost.
Right.
But look at that. I mean, see how much good are we doing versus how much bad are we doing? Mm-hmm. Chlorhexidine, 0.2% is used as a skin antiseptic. 0.12%, almost half strength, is used in a product that's used in dentistry as a rinse. But 0.2% is where most of the studies are done because that's what's used most times. Again, 10 minutes to kill Candida albicans, Staph aureus. 2 hours required to kill Aethocallus. Aethocallus is Enterococcus faecalis. It causes about 70 to 90%, depending on who you read, of our endodontic infections, which is endodontics is root canal. So people who have root canal therapy who have had infections inside the tooth, most times the Aethocallus takes 2 hours for 0.2% to kill Aethocallus.
John, let me ask a question. Don't mind if I ask a question here. Aethocallus, that kind of indicates to me that that's from the digestive tract.
Yeah, it's
the gut.
But it can get it there. It's originally from the gut, but it gets into the mouth by various means, and also it's a real problem in periodontic people who have periodontitis who have had root canal therapy. You can culture this out of the periodontal pockets. It's hard to kill by some of these agents, but the problem is 0.0001% is toxic to periodontal ligament cells. 0.005% causes 100% cell death of fibroblasts, which again are some of the cells involved in wound healing in skin and in the mouth. And so, you know, that's a problem when 0.12%, which is what's used in most dental rinses, 2 minutes is going to kill the osteoblasts, which are doing it. But they're not really all that effective. Go back, they're not really all that effective in some of these other. So they're real good against our cells, but they're not necessarily all that good against the pathogens for which they're intended, which leads us to infection or bile burden. Infection, a lot of people shy away from because infectious, you know, to me, infection, and I was brought up to, you know, when I was in school, infection technically is if it's there, if the pathogen is there, it's infected, whether you have pus or a real pathology or not. But they've kind of shied away. They use bioburden now and critical colonization, which is defined as the presence of microbes to the extent that healing is adversely affected. And another thing, infected wounds don't heal. So if a wound is healing, it's not infected. If it's infected, it's not going to heal. It just isn't. Well, there are certain signs of critical colonization. And as a dentist, I look at this, and the first thing that comes to my mind is dry socket alveolar osteitis, which is there's no doubt, although there are some people who will argue with you. I don't know how you can. The literature is pretty clear, and it makes perfect sense that the colonization is probably the single most important thing that causes dry socket, and the loss of the blood clot is due to that. It's not the cause of it. It's due to that. But anyway, critical colonization is a real issue, and bioburden is a real issue in wound healing. Bioburden, there are other things that contribute to it, compromised circulation. There's always going to be necrotic, and I'm always thinking as a dentist, I'm thinking like surgery or extracted tooth. There's always going to be dead tissue. There's always foreign material going to be getting in it, food, whatever. Arid condition isn't a real issue in the mouth, but it is on the skin again and the environment again. So in the mouth, you've got a real nasty environment. Bioburden is a real issue in wound healing, and especially in dentistry, that has not really been addressed very well. We have systemic antibiotics, and we have some of these antiseptics, but I just saw some data that makes you wonder how wise it is to use some of those. One of the things, if you look at wound care research that you see more and more all the time, is that bioburden is being understood as becoming, it's more critical than it was originally understood. I read one article that said, and they were talking about surgery, said it would be ideal if you could follow the scalpel blade just a half inch behind it with something to address bioburden. Well, that's not practical, but that's how important it is. Bioburden needs to be addressed as quickly as possible after injury, or even if that injury is surgery.
But don't they already do that? Don't they already do that by using broad-spectrum antibiotics during and after surgery?
Yeah, but the problem. But then we got a problem, and that you lead right into it. The problem is we're getting more and more bacteria that are becoming resistant to systemic and topical antibiotics.
Okay.
And so now the recommendation is that we use, instead of antibiotics, the recommendation now is to go with dressings with topical antiseptic agents. Well, we've already talked about that a little bit, but the problem with antiseptics is we have some allergies, we have toxicities, and they're effective. They're real effective against our cells that often wound healing. They're not necessarily all that effective, comparatively speaking, against the pathogens. So what is the recommendation? Well, the recommendation to go back, we're still stuck with using antiseptic agents. Well, it'd be nice if we could do something about that.
Mm-hmm.
which is where we are in our company. Pain. Well, I usually skip over this because, I mean, the dentists and physicians understand that pain is something that the brain has to do with the brain. But you have nociceptors, which are receptors that are in tissues and skin. When they're stimulated, there's an alteration in the ion concentration, and you have the nerve impulse that goes to the brain is interpreted as pain. We usually use anesthetics to either prevent pain or to treat pain. And what anesthetics do is they prevent the sodium influx. The first thing that happens after stimulation is sodium ions, which are lined on the outside of the nerve membrane, they influx into the cell. The potassium comes out, and you have depolarization, and you have the nerve impulse that's working its way toward the brain. Most anesthetics are sodium channel blockers. They are absorbed into the, they're absorbed into the tissue, into the neurons. They block the sodium channels. They block that function, but they also do other things to the cell physiology, and they basically paralyze the neuron, and you get the anesthetic or the numb sensation. So that's what anesthetics do, and these are a few examples of some of the anesthetics that we use. The problem is there's toxicity inherent to anesthetics. Central nervous system, the cytotoxicity refers to toxic to various cells, and then there's allergies. Lidocaine, which is xylocaine, and which is used often in medicine, and probably more often in the medicine industry than the other local anesthetic, overdose with that, it affects the CNS. You can get seizures, and it can affect the heart, the rhythm of the heart. Even benzocaine, which is OTC, it's an over-the-counter product that's in lots of over-the-counter products. It's a topical anesthetic, but overdose, you could get methemoglobinemia from that. And if you'll go to a drugstore or grocery store and go to that department and pick up any product that has benzocaine and flip it over, read the directions, it'll say use no more than 4 times a day unless otherwise directed by your physician or dentist or whatever. But there's a reason that's on there, because you can't just have a cavalier attitude about even benzocaine. And benzocaine is what's used for teething babies. But it's not totally safe. So we have some problems with even these topical anesthetics. Okay, another thing about pain is that pain is a vasoconstrictor. Let me just draw your attention down to the bottom, and you see Cho and Hunt. Thomas K. Hunt is a big name in wound care research. He's in San Francisco. He's kind of like E.F. Hutton. Some of the older people remember those commercials, but when E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. Well, when Thomas K. Hunt speaks, people listen when he's talking about wound care. And he says, and this was in a chapter of one of the books that he was a contributor to, pain is a vasoconstrictor and should be corrected. Special care should be taken to avoid vasoconstriction during the first day. A short period of compromised perfusion is sufficient to reduce oxygen and healing. So pain is important not only because it hurts, but because it slows the healing process down. Some of the things vasoconstrictor does, this is pretty obvious, it's going to reduce oxygen and nutrients and cells to the area, and if you're treating with systemic antibiotic, it's going to reduce the amount of meds to the area. The problem with pain management historically is that it tends to be underestimated. I'm treating a patient. I don't feel their pain. I don't care what the politicians say. I really can't feel their pain. And you tend to underestimate, and therefore we tend to undertreat. And they've shown, and now we're talking about surgery. These studies usually done with surgery. And so patient control analgesia is where you've had surgery and you've got that thing, you're punching the button all day long, even though you know the morphine can only come certain periods of time. You've got to be a period of time before you can use it again. But it still works best because you don't have the delay waiting for the nurse to show up and give you the medication and all that. Not bad-mouthing nurses at all, but they're busy and they can't be there as quickly as that button is. So PCA works the best, but there are still limitations and restrictions to narcotics. You can't take it any time you want to. You have to wait a certain amount of time because of the toxicity. And also, they've shown that systemic narcotics aren't effective enough usually to deal with pain to the point where you eliminate the vasoconstriction. Let's face it, as much as anything, narcotics I still feel the pain, but I don't care as much. You still feel it, but it helps you not care quite as much. And it does reduce some of the pain, but it's not as effective as it could be. And so even systemic narcotics don't address the vasoconstriction aspect of pain. Mm. And it'd be nice if we could do something about that. Done studies with topical anesthetics, and these studies were done after tooth extraction, which is a good model for pain studies. Bupivacaine is a local anesthetic, long-acting. Morphine, of course, is a narcotic. They're ineffective topically. Benzocaine's effective. It helps stop the pain after extraction, but the problem, again, is it's so toxic that it slows the healing process down. So if you don't overdo it and get that hemoglobinemia, you're at least going to slow the healing process down. These are studies in 2007 and 2008. So we really don't have much topically that we can do to help. Once we basically, with pain, we basically are, until recently, restricted to systemic medications, either OTC or narcotics or something. Okay, now I'm really shifting gears. Foods and wound management, what in the world is coming up? Well, it may be surprising to many in your audience that foods and food-related products have been shown in well-controlled clinical studies to be equal to or better than current standard of care for burns and other wounds. Now, some people, that's not surprising to, but I bet you there are some people that are surprised to hear that. Mm-hmm. There's a study done with banana leaf dressing, and again, here we are at Vaseline. You remember I mentioned that Shane McAnally mentioned that the dermatologists are getting to the point where they're just using Vaseline to treat wounds, which makes my blood run cold because I don't want anybody putting Vaseline on a really bad wound anyway. But,
right.
But there was a study done with banana leaf dressing, which is a food-related product, obviously, in donor graft sites, and most people understand donor graft sites are the sites that really, really are painful. And the banana leaf dressing outperformed Vaseline on every parameter of the study. VAS refers to, and just for the people that may not understand this, the visual analog scale is one of the ways by which we measure pain in clinical studies. And what you do is you draw a line on a piece of paper. It's 10 centimeters long. You don't have any numbers or anything. It's just a line segment there, 10 centimeters long. And you ask the person at a point in time just to mark down on that line with on the very extreme left side is no pain, the extreme right side is horrible, excruciating pain, and mark somewhere on that line where they think they are. Well, banana leaf dressing, 1 versus 7 on pain relief.
Wow.
On dressing removal, 1 versus almost 10. Of course, you can imagine. Dressing removal can be very painful.
Mm-hmm.
And epithelialization, 3 days quicker with just banana leaf dressing versus a standard of care. And, of course, that was a statistically significant study. They also studied potato peel dressings, which this was not done in the United States, but they've been using potato peels in burn units for 9 years, but they showed in this study that it was equivalent to banana leaf dressing. The thing about these two, banana leaf and potato peel, it wasn't that there was any particular agent in those products that was doing anything, but what was happening is they were protecting the wound and they were maintaining the moisture in the wound. That's all it was. That shows you how just maintaining moisture and protecting a wound can make a big difference.
So there wasn't any active. I was going to ask you what the active.
No, they said that as far as they could tell, there wasn't. It was just a matter of, especially banana leaf. you know, there's a waxy covering. Or it was just protecting wood and just keeping it from drying out.
Wow.
Thank you. So it's just that helps show what just keeping a wood moist can do. Okay, now this gets interesting. Honey versus silver sulfadiazine. Most people, I think, or a lot of people, heard of silvadine, which is still the standard of care in treating burns. It's a cream. It's a white cream that you put on burns. It's a very potent antibiotic, and they're still using it. Honey versus silvadine. Well, silvadine is going to knock the socks off of honey for sure. Well, no, let's see. Honey was superior in controlling infection. That may be shocking to some people. Honey was better than a potent antimicrobial antibiotic. It was faster in granulation, healing time, pain relief, and incidence of scarring. These were from two separate studies, probably 7 years apart. I just combined the results, but that's what they saw. Honey was better than the standard of care, silvadine and burns, a lot better. And then honey versus Eucerin, this is another study. Eucerin is a product that was developed in Scotland. It's like bacon. It's real toxic. I mean, it's boric acid and lime. But they use it to treat pusty, infected, abscessed wounds. And they were using honey on these. Well, you got to be nuts to use honey. Put food on an infected wound. Well, guess what? Quicker healing, shorter hospital stays. Honey is now recommended to dress infected wounds. And with, again, quicker healing implies no infection. Remember, an infected wound doesn't heal. So if there's healing taking place, there's less infection. So the standard of care was being kicked around by honey, of all things. And you go to PubMed now and you look up honey, and there's all kinds of research showing honey being used to treat wounds. And what honey basically is doing is producing a little bit of hydrogen peroxide, which is toxic to our cells too, but it's a tiny little bit, and it's helping to maintain the moisture, and it's killing some bacteria, and basically it's just helping maintain the moisture, and it's not causing any real major damage, the main thing. Okay, mannans. Remember I mentioned mannans way back, that mannans helps stimulate macrophage activity. It's a sugar. It's a polysaccharide. And people in the South might recognize the field of aloe vera, Alabama, Barbadensis Miller. And you mentioned that Dr. McAnally, who just walked in, by the way, so when we have our question answer, he's available to answer questions somebody might have, but he's the guy who identified the active ingredient aloe vera. This is from the 1996 Merck Index. You look up ACE mannan, and you're going to find that it's a polydispersed, beta-linked, acetylated mannan from Aloe Barbadensis Miller. And on the third line, you see B.H. McAnally, Bill McAnally.
Mm-hmm.
He's the guy who discovered it.
Oh, great.
And there have been, I don't know, 150, 200 papers probably published now on ACE mannan, somewhere along. This is one of them, published in 1995 by Alice Johnson, University of Texas Health Science Center, showed that ACE mannan inhibited the adherence of Pseudomonas aeruginosa to human lung epithelial cells. By and large, bacteria have to be able to colonize. They have to be able to adhere to your host tissues and colonize before they cause damage. If you can prevent a pathogen from colonizing and adhering to your cells, you're not really going to have much of a problem with infection. So ACE mannan prevented, and Pseudomonas aeruginosa, as you know, is a real, real potent pathogen, especially in lungs, but also burn patients have a real problem with that. That's what kills burn patients a lot. Another study by Dave Busby at Texas A&M University was with mice with a murine sarcoma model. This is a real potent tumor model where 100% of the mice with this tumor die. And he was testing all kinds of potential chemotherapeutic agents, none of which had saved the life of a single mouse. And then he tested with ACE mannan and he gave all the mice the tumor, and then half of them he injected 1 milligram per kilogram of intraperitoneal of ACE mannan. Then he went on a trip for 2 weeks. I think he went on vacation and on a business trip, came back. And one of the students said, Dr. Busby, what do we do with these live mice? And his answer was, there aren't any live mice. They're all dead. He said, no. Well, 44% of those mice were still alive. Not all of them, but 44% of the ACE mannan were alive. And the interesting thing is, when he re-injected those mice with the tumor cells the tumor didn't take, they had developed tumor immunity.
Wow.
So he couldn't even cause the tumor to come back with those cells. So that was a very interesting study.
Wow.
Jasper Cullen is a really impressive, really pretty. She's a tall Indian lady from India, but she's a really brilliant investigator, and she was the lead investigator for the United States Department of Defense back in the 80s and early 90s, I think, looking for testing for antiviral agents, specifically for anti-HIV agents. And she showed, and she was surprised, this is the best result she saw with anything, especially with an agent with hepatotoxicity. But it inhibited replication in vitro of the AIDS virus. So this sugar in aloe vera is shown to be antibacterial, anti-tumor, and antiviral. And we did, you know, we won't get into the human studies, but we did some human studies too. Okay, cytotoxicity of the Carrington. He developed the Carrington gel. He took the ACE band and he put it in the first hydrogel. It's the first widely marketed hydrogel wound dressing in the world. It may be the first hydrogel wound dressing, but certainly the first widely marketed hydrogel wound dressing. And it was used especially against non-healing wounds. Where it really took off is when they were started treating patients that had wounds and they had been treating for 6 months, a year, 18 months. They weren't healing. They put this gel on, and then in 6 weeks they were healed. That got people's attention. And then it didn't always happen in 6 weeks, but I mean they started healing, and that's how this product really took off. Well, Alice Johnson, who did the Pseudomonas study a minute ago, she also looked at the cytotoxicity of this product versus these three products at the top that are common wound cleansers. And look, in 15 minutes against human fibroblasts, 100% kill by these products that we use to treat wounds. Remember I said almost always we're doing more damage than we are good. Right. And Carrington gel there is 5%. Bill had that at that time. He was using a synthetic. He was using some biocides too, but he was using the most gentle system he could use. He's a brilliant person, and he had a combination of preservatives that were made it as easy and gentle on the tissues as possible. So there's only a 5% kill, which is not as good as 1%, but a whole lot better than 100%. So one of the reasons this was such a good product was it wasn't damaging our cells. It was keeping wounds moist, but it was also doing a lot of other things, as we'll see. We modified that product to make it suitable for intraoral use, and we, since we're close to Baylor College of Dentistry, went to Dallas, and they did a study for us using Orabase as a control and our hydrogel. And about the time we started the study, we developed a freeze-dried version of the hydrogel. It's like cotton. You put it in the mouth, stick it to the aphis ulcer, which is a canker sore. That's a term for canker sore, and it slowly rehydrated back to the gel from the saliva. So those were the three groups, and here's what we saw in healing time. Well, you know, number one, you say big deal canker sores, but when you look at this, this is intriguing at the very least, because think about it. The mouth is one of the best. Has one of the best environments for wound healing. We've got a tremendous blood supply in the mouth, and we have a moist environment. And now, and every piece of literature I've ever read, when you look at aphis ulcers, it takes 7 to 10 days, 7 to 14 days normally for it to heal. I've never seen it where it said 5 or 6 days to heal. But the point is, against standard therapy, both of the products that we developed, they heal 2 days faster than with standard therapy. And you know, again, it's a big deal, but well, think about it. It's hard to make things heal faster in the mouth because you've already got an ideal wound healing environment. So that was really intriguing. That was published in the Journal of Wounds in 1994. And unbeknownst to us, they did another study that they published the next year just seeing how the pain relief. Well, there was no difference between the pain relief provided by this product that has no drugs in it versus Orabase, which is a standard therapy. So that was published in the Journal of Dental Research the next year. So besides healing faster, it gave the same amount of pain relief. Okay, another study that we didn't know about until was published in 1988. This is a very intriguing study. This was done in Puerto Rico, I believe. And I don't think we could do this now, but back then they took guinea pigs, they gave them third-degree burns, they used a hot plate, constant temperature, pressure, and time, and all that, gave them equivalent injuries and divided them into four groups. You have the negative control group, occlusal gauze dressing, and silvadine. Of course, silvadine is the standard of care today, even, for burns. And then aspirin, a third group is aspirin cream, and then the wound gel from the Bill developed. This was done because there was a guy about that time who had decided that aspirin was the active ingredient in aloe vera, which is interesting since aloe vera contains not one shred of salicylate, but that's a different story. But anyway, they decided that what they were expecting to see was that that the third, you know, the aspirin group and the dermal wound group, gel group, were going to heal at about the same rate, and that was going to show that aspirin was indeed the active ingredient. And, of course, silvodine was going to do the best because it's the standard of care.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is what they found. Now, that's impressive. The next best group took 50% longer to heal. And silvodine didn't even do as well as aspirin. Of course, there's no real difference between them. Those three, there's no significant difference. But silvodine didn't even do any better than just the gauze dressing.
Hmm.
But look how, but when you're talking about third-degree burns, days are critical, as you well know, David. I mean, we're talking life and death here.
Right.
And it took 50% longer. So obviously, aspirin wasn't the active ingredient, but look at that. And that's the reason we started getting, we could not label this product for third-degree burns because third-degree burn products have to be sterile. This was not a sterile product. It was a preserved product. But physicians can practice medicine. And so, based, I'm sure, on the results of this study, we started getting calls from burn units. I remember we got one from Oklahoma City and one, I think, in Phoenix area and two or three others. They were using this product on their burn units because they were able to do their grafting procedures days sooner than they ever had because the granulation bed was being established days sooner.
Mm.
So this product, even though we couldn't label it for such, was being used for that. They also did a study, in this original study with the guinea pigs, on bacterial growth. And the standard, you do that, you do a punch biopsy, and then you look for 100,000 CFUs per gram. CFU means colony-forming unit, which is another term for a viable cell. So a live, viable cell, bacterial cell that has the potential to reproduce. So 100,000 CFUs per gram. Well, you can see that Carrington Dermal Wound Gel, which has no drug, did just as well as silvodine. And preventing infection. But which product, if your son or daughter or child or baby had a third-degree burn, which would you? Would you want to go to the doctor and have them use standard therapy, or would you rather use this product and be insistent about it? So this was published in Journal of Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery in 1988. Well, another study that was being done that we didn't know about was with our freeze-dried product, and this was done by an oral surgeon here in Texas. He had been using clindamycin, because it had been shown that clindamycin reduces the incidence of dry socket, which is a real problem after extraction, usually lower third and molars, which lower wisdom teeth. Dry socket is extremely painful. You lose the clot, and the healing is delayed, and they're in real pain. And, I mean, people have committed suicide with dry socket. It's very painful. And so oral surgeons, especially the dentists, are like trying to do anything they can to reduce the incidence. He'd been using clindamycin, but he read about our product, he started using it, and he said, man, I'm seeing even better results. So he did his own study, and you look at the end value, and obviously there are lots of, that's good for any study. So almost 1,000 socket, lower third molar is what you really focus on dry socket, alveolar osteitis, because that's where the vast majority of dry socket occurs. So anyway, good study, and this is what he saw. And especially lower third molar, 8% versus 1%. And all he did was he just put two of those little pledges of the freeze-dried socket in the product in the socket at the time of surgery and sent them on their way. But, you know, 12 out of 1,000 versus 80 out of 1,000 is really significant if you're an oral surgeon that has to treat these patients
right. For
several days in a row. They are not happy patients.
Right.
And they shouldn't be. But anyway, that was a significant study. That was published in the Journal of Oral Surgery 7 years ago.
Now, one question I had,
okay.
John, is how frequently did he administer that the hydrogel to the spot?
Well, that's what I'm saying. He used gel foam, and at the time of surgery he put the gel foam in, and that's the only time they received the clindamycin. And with the hydrogel, all he did is he put two of the little cotton pledges in at the time of surgery. That's all it was. That's all. He didn't have any. And sent on their way.
Really?
Usually it happens, dry socket usually happens about day three after extraction. So that's all it was just that one treatment. And
wow.
You got those kind of results. That's 8% looks real good to most oral surgeons because most lower third molars, you look in the literature at 15, 20, 25, 30%. 15% is real common, 20%. So 8% looks real good, but 1% looks real nice. So that's the reason it was accepted pretty quickly in the journal.
Right.
Okay. Okay, Now, I found this. This was a study that was published a couple of years ago. I just found this just a few weeks ago, and I don't even know who these people are. I don't remember what country they're in, but anyways, in the Journal of Oral Tissue Engineering. But they were using ace mannan, the active ingredient aloe vera, and periodontal fibroblasts and tooth pulple fibroblasts, and they showed that it increased the messenger RNA expression and the synthesis of bone morphogenic protein. So the implication is that it can help speed the healing of bone, which has application not just in the mouth but elsewhere in the body. So that was I just stumbled across that study just a few weeks ago. So there's still people out there studying ace mannan, but that's pretty impressive. Okay, now I've showed this slide because for years and years Bill has been talking about one of the things we're doing is we're feeding the macrophages because we know they phagocytize, they take in the ace mannan and the mannans, and that the mannans stimulate their activity. But, you know, nowhere else had we ever heard anybody ever use or talk about topical nutrition. It's always just what we usually think of when we think of nutrition. And it's I've always been looking for something. I finally found this just a couple of years ago, and it was in 1995, but I found one other since then. But there's two other publications where they actually looked at nutrients, topical nutrition. And in this study, they had developed a culture, a skin substitute that had a lot of keratinocytes and fibroblasts, and they had a control group and a test group, and they would just flood that test group with nutrient broth, and they showed that it did grow faster and larger, and so that topical nutrition did make a difference in this study in wound healing. It was just nice to not be the only ones at the top of the mountain talking and screaming about topical nutrition. It's just kind of nice to have somebody else on your side. But
right.
Anyway, so we're not the only ones. There are a couple other out there that are doing that. But we think that the topical nutrition is important. And it's been shown in lots of studies, especially base mannan, that the mannan concentration in the blood or at the wound site itself is a determinant of the potency of the immune cell response. Well, again, immune system is what controls wound healing. So all those immune cells are what are involved in wound healing. And this was a study or a paper done by Shepetkin in 2006 where he was showing talking about the stimulation of macrophages. And this is a little slide showing plant polysaccharides, not just mannans, but other plant polysaccharides and how they activate. But when macrophages take them in, they proliferate. They also produce reactive oxygen species, which is the way they kill bacteria. They ingest them, and then they produce those and actually kill them inside the cell. They also produce all these different cytokines, and again, the cytokine production is how the macrophage controls the wound healing process. So they were showing how ingestion by macrophages of these plant polysaccharides stimulates macrophage activity. This is from the same article, but this shows how macrophages are actually geared to take in these different polysaccharides. On the left, you see that it's actually phagocytizing or ingesting plant polysaccharides. But also there are all kinds of receptors all along the cell membrane of macrophages that are geared to taking in all these different saccharides. But it is interesting that the only specific one that you see is a mannan receptor, a mannose receptor. So they take in different polysaccharides, but they're specifically geared to take in mannan. So they endocytose, or they have receptors that take in all these different saccharides, and specifically mannans. They also phagocytize it, but this shows that once they're in the cell, boy, it kicks into high gear. So,
could you point? No doubt. Could you use your?
Can I use?
Yes.
Oh,
please.
Okay. I'm sorry. I forgot that I had control of this cursor. This shows the phagocytosis.
Okay.
And then this is the mannose receptor, and you can see mannan. It specifically talks about mannans, and it just talks generally polysaccharides. Mm-hmm. I believe CR3. There are several of these others. CR3, toll-like receptor 4. And some of these others also take in mannan, too. So they take in various polysaccharides, including mannan. And then there's the specific mannose receptor that takes in mannan. So macrophages are geared to take in mannan. And the higher the mannan concentration, the more active the macrophage. So here we are. The higher the mannan concentration, the more efficiently that they recognize and internalize mannan, that increases their phagocytic activity, which is the way by which they kill bacteria and they clean the wound, and then they also produce more cytokines, which the bottom line is, the higher the mannan concentration, the better the wound healing and infection control. Okay, that's one of the main things that we've incorporated into our product, which is this is the product we have on the market now. We have received FDA approval of another product that will be for external use, and then we've got one or two other products that will be coming online before too awful long. But okay, our product is called Socket Gel, and we just want to show you how we've incorporated these concepts into our product. We've got a lot of polysaccharides, specifically these beta-linked mannans in socket gel. Well, they stimulate macrophage activity, which causes enhanced wound healing and infection control. Okay, so if you get the immune system working faster and better, you're going to have fewer infections and better wound healing. So one of the things we do is we stimulate macrophage activity. It also serves as a thickening agent. This is a highly charged molecule, this gel, and I'll show you a picture of it later, but it's a gel that you put right into the extraction site or onto an aphthous ulcer, a canker sore, or any kind of surgical site, and it's a thin layer of the gel adheres to the wound bed, and it lasts for a few hours, and so this helps the gel stick to the tissue. It also assists in hemostasis, a highly charged molecule, so it's going to help with hemostasis, with the control of bleeding, and it's also going to help stabilize the blood clot and the fibrin matrix that's developed early on in wound healing. Okay, the mannans inhibit microbes and they kill microbes. So they stimulate macrophage activity, but they also directly affect microbes also. They inhibit microbes by binding to cellular mannose binding lectins. And these are proteins that are on the cell walls of bacteria and fungi, and they're also on our cell membranes. And that's one of the main means by which bacteria adhere to our tissues and they colonize. And remember back when I showed you that slide where it showed that ACE mannan inhibited the adherence of Pseudomonas aeruginosa to the lung tissue, human lung tissue?
Right.
Well, if you prevent that, you're not killing the microbe, but if you prevent that colonization, you're going to prevent infection, okay? But also, these saccharides also directly kill bacteria because they bind cations. They bind positively charged ions like calcium and magnesium, which are in the cell wall and cell membrane, and they disrupt the cell membrane and they actually kill the pathogens. This does not affect our cells because the cell membrane of bacteria are more like the membrane that kind of surrounds mitochondria that are inside our cells. They're more easily disrupted. And so this doesn't affect our cells. So these are toxic to our cells, but they're very toxic to bacteria and fungal cells. And this was a study we did, just in vitro study, showing that the socket gel does indeed bind free calcium ions pretty quickly. And so it does bind those calcium ions. We also have a tiny little bit of essential oils in our product. And in our 10-gram syringe of product, we probably have about a half a drop, maybe not quite a half a drop of total of these essential oils. And they serve as flavoring agents. They're real mild flavor agents, but they're also part of the preservative system. There's lots of data in the literature that shows that these combinations of these oils and other oils, but these oils in real tiny concentrations they're synergistic and they're very potent antibacterial, antifungal, and antiviral. So this is part of we have a little tiny bit of this in the product for flavoring, but as an important part of the preservative system. Okay, they prevent growth at very low concentrations. They disrupt the cell membrane by a different mechanism, and they cause leakage of all these ingredients or these factors. And it's important to note that there's no resistance that's developed through these mechanisms. One of the things that Bill is really good about is Bill's real smart, and we all are fairly intelligent. And we've noticed that God's pretty smart too, and God knew what he's doing when he did things, and we're just using the mechanisms that he put in nature to protect these plants. Trees and all these food plants have been around for a long time, let's face it, and they're still surviving out in a very hostile environment. We're just using the same mechanisms that they are using to protect themselves against viruses and bacteria and fungi. And there's no resistance to the amount of mutation that bacteria would have to go through to become resistant to these. It's just overwhelming. It's not going to happen. It's pretty simple for bacteria to become resistant to antibiotics. To become resistant to this is going to be really, really difficult. Right. So we're using mechanisms that they're not going to develop resistance to, like they have to antibiotics.
That's huge.
That's huge. Okay, preservative challenge test is a USP 51 test. And this is a test that all preserved products have to pass by law before they're allowed by FDA to go on the market. You test against these three bacterial species and the two bottom fungal species. And this just shows these are the results from our test. And using these food preservative systems that are found in foods, and let me also just mention this, that the concentration of the ingredients in our product, almost all of the ingredients are at concentrations, just a tiny fraction of what is found in the food. So there are one or two that are almost at that concentration, but none of them are above the concentration of found food. And the vast majority are concentrations of a very small fraction. So these are concentrations are very, very safe, but the combination, as you can see, is very effective. No growth means total kill. So we passed the preservative challenge test with this food preservative system. But we realized that even though this is the only test we had to do by law, we need to do more studies because we couldn't go to dentists and say, look, we've got a product we want you to put in women's in the mouth, and by the way, it's 100% food ingredients. If somebody came to me, I'd just show them the door because you're worried about sustaining an infection. So we knew we had a lot more studies to do. So there's a contract laboratory in Dallas that does it's approved by FDA and also by the Drug Enforcement Administration. But it's a micro lab in Dallas, and they did all these studies. We picked out these four bacterial species involved in tooth decay. And what they did is that you look at the top here. At the top here, they tested at 30 seconds, 5 minutes, 1, 6, 12, and 24 hours. And by law, you have to have at least a 2-log reduction to be considered antimicrobial. 2-log means you have to reduce the numbers by at least 100 times. Well, you'll see that at 30 seconds, on everything that was tested, there was at least a 2-log reduction. And no growth, this is a time kill study, at no growth means complete kill. So at 30 seconds, most of the species that were tested, our product completely killed these pathogens, even at 30 seconds, and of course it was working even 24 hours later. But at least there was at least a 2-log reduction, and then there's by 1 hour on everything, there was complete kill. Also, it's important to mention that Strep mutans and Strep sabrinus are two of the Viridans group that we're worried about when we pre-medicate people who have had rheumatoid arthritis, a rheumatic fever, or they've had other, prolapsed mitral valve, or they have prosthetic hip or whatever. And of course, the Heart Association is changing the protocols all the time, but historically we've always pre-medicated because we're worried about bacterial endocarditis, which will just destroy heart valves in nothing flat. So these are also, besides causing tooth decay, these are two of the Viridans group that you are worried about that we pre-medicate against. So this shows that this is very effective against these bacterial species. We also did minimum inhibitory concentration studies. This product's in the mouth. It's going to be diluted some by blood and saliva. This shows that even 10% was still effective against these, and 20% was still effective, which there's no growth even against these. So it can be diluted a lot and still be effective. But another reason we did these studies is because, and this is just off in another direction, but it's important, we think. We are real big in nutrition and doing things the natural way as much as possible. And we are real big on probiotics and prebiotics. And probiotics are, I think most people have heard of those by now, but you see the yogurt being advertised and getting the bacteria, the favorable bacteria into the lower GI tract.
Right.
We wanted to show that we were not going to be disturbing or harming these bacteria. By the time this product, number one, you're not using very much, but number two, by the time this gets down into the lower GI tract, obviously it's not going to be harming. So we're not doing any harm at all. In fact, the ACE mannan, the mannan is a beta link mannan, so it's not being affected by enzymes. It's not being degraded in the mouth or in the GI tract until you get in the lower GI tract, and they are prebiotics. Prebiotics are defined as foods that support and feed the good bacteria. So actually, this product actually does some good. It doesn't do any harm, but it actually can serve as a prebiotic. But we wanted to do this, too, to show that it works in the mouth at lower concentrations, but also it's not going to be causing any problem by the time it gets to the lower GI tract. These are four that's important. These are four bacterial species involved in periodontal disease. And again, at 30 seconds, you see there's at least a 2 log reduction, complete kill with these two species, and by 1 hour, there's a complete kill. And so these were effective against these bacteria involved in periodontal disease. And again, even 4% was effective against Porphyromonas gingivalis, and and on these, 35% so this is a little more potent, harder to kill this particular bacterium, but still, it can be diluted quite a bit, and basically it's still going to be effective. And the reality is that thin layer that's adhering to the tissue, it's not really being diluted. I mean, it's going to last there, so really it's still at 100%. When you think that thin layer that's actually doing the work that's coming in contact, it's eventually going to wash away in 3 to 4 hours, but while it's still there, it's really not diluted, so that's not a major issue. But while we were at it, we thought we'd go ahead and do those concentration studies. Strep pyogenes causes strep throat and also causes rheumatic fever, which is what we worry about, pre-medicating against bacterial endocarditis. And again, there's at least a 2 log reduction in 30 seconds, and 15% was affected against strep pyogenes. And we've already seen this slide, but I want to bring you back to this and make a really important point. Again, you see that these concentrations of sodium hypochlorite, which is in bleach, and 4% takes 5 minutes to kill E. faecalis and Candida albicans, even that strong a concentration. And chlorhexidine, which is used as skin cleanser, and 12.12% is used in the mouth and dental rinses, but almost double that strength takes 2 hours to kill E. faecalis, 10 minutes to kill Candida, which causes thrush, which is the fungus that causes thrush. So that shows you what those do, but Candida albicans, 30 seconds, gone with our product.
Wow.
Didn't take minutes. It was gone in 30 seconds.
Wow.
And remember, 12% was effective. Instead of 2 hours, to kill 30 seconds, E. faecalis was gone with our product.
Wow.
So the point is, our product is extremely potent. It is extremely, the preservative system is extremely potent. It is not going to sustain an infection in the mouth. And yet these mechanisms do not affect our cells, and they're not toxic to our cells. And one of the things that people see, oral surgeons, they'll be treating patients, and they'll bring their patient back in 7 days for a recall, and they say it looked like they've been healing for 2 weeks. So that's clinical evidence to show that. But anyway, that shows how potent these preservative systems that are found in foods can be if you use the right combinations. And again, this was just the concentration study. Okay, pain relief. We are working our way toward the end, I promise. But pain relief, remember how important pain is. Besides hurting, it's also slowing the healing process down because of vasoconstriction. Okay, the menins also are what give the pain relief from our product because they bind the sodium. I remember that anesthetics work by preventing the sodium influx. They block the sodium channel. Well, this product is not fat soluble. It is not being absorbed into the neuron like anesthetics are. And the gel is lying on top of the wound, but that's where the sodium ions are. So this product is, the gel is binding the sodium ions, and calcium ions are also involved in some cases with in pain, especially with chronic inflammatory type conditions where there's pain. But mostly you think of sodium ions with membrane depolarization and pain. This product is binding the sodium ions to prevent their influx, but you're not getting the anesthetic effect. You're not getting the numbness. You're getting an analgesic type effect. So we wanted that. Most people don't like the numb sensation, but they prefer it over pain. But another thing is we wanted the sticky feature because, for example, under a denture, if you're using benzocaine or something and you're anesthetizing tissue and you've got a high spot and you're rubbing an ulcer on your mucosa, well, that's not good. With this product, you're going to know that you still have a high spot. You're going to go to the dentist and get it adjusted. But once you get adjusted, then this will stop the pain. So it's a safety feature that we want to build into this product. This shows, we saw a slide like this with calcium. This shows how fast socket gel binds sodium ions in B. vitro. And these are 30-second intervals, so you can see in 1 minute it's happening pretty quickly. So it starts working very quickly, which leads us into this slide. And I mentioned to you that just today in General Dentistry, an article came out that we that I was a co-author in. And this is one of the charts in it. This was done in immediate denture patients at the 24-hour post-op. And immediate dentures are called that because, for those of you who don't know, most people don't want to go without teeth. So most people, they'll have their teeth extracted and the denture put in that same appointment. And then at 24 hours later, they come in for an adjustment. They're very sore. They're hurting, obviously, at 24 hours. So we did a study at that 24-hour appointment. We had 44 patients. And what we did is, after the adjustment, those who agreed to take part in the study, signed informed consent and all that, what they did was they would sit down, then we had them take their denture out, which hurts, and dry the denture out and put it back in. Well, that hurts. And so they were doing that, but at 1 minute, we would have them mark down their score. We used a scale of 0 to 10, 0 no pain, 10 horrible excruciating pain. And we just asked them to write down, 3, 4, 7, 8, whatever their score was. And so at 1 minute, they marked it down, and then at 3 minutes, they marked it down again, and then 2 minutes later, and then again at 10 minutes. Hmm. So, and then after they marked that down, then they took the denture out, dried it out, then we put the socket gel in the denture and put it back in place and started the process all over again, which you normally would expect it to go back to at least a 5.4 for the mean for the 44 patients. But not only did it not do that, but we got statistically significant reductions in pain even at 1 minute. And that P is less than 0.0001. That's for all of these. So even at 1 minute, we had a very statistically significant reduction. And that goes back to this slide. You can sit there and watch it, and that's in the 30 or 40 seconds, they say, oh, it's starting to work. So they were starting to get pain relief immediately, and then they kept improving, and then by 10 minutes, we got down to two. And you can look at a patient, and there's a big difference between 5 and 2. At 5, they're kind of frowning, and they're sitting there. At 2, they're smiling and visiting. Well, I mean, they're feeling some discomfort, but there's a big difference. So that was a simple little study. It was a crossover study. Each person served as his or her own control, which is a real nice way to do this type of a study. We stopped at 10 minutes because we wanted to do this study, get it done in 3 or 4 months instead of 3 or 4 years. If we were going to take an hour, it was going to take a long time to get people to agree to that. So we stopped at 10 minutes. There's no doubt if we went on out, it would keep getting better. But you can see that there's not much difference in 10 minutes. It's just the factor of time. And all these patients were on narcotic also, by the way. Most of them were on Lortab or something, Schedule 3 narcotics. So they were all taking narcotic. So this is how this improves their pain relief, even on top of narcotic. This just came out today. That kind of shows how fast it starts working. Okay, we're getting real close. Just a summary. First, do no harm is a nice rule, but that's almost as possible. So really, is you do as little harm as possible. And that's an extremely important thing. In wound care, you want to provide an environment conducive to optimal healing. You want to protect from mechanical injury. That's what wound dressings do, among other things. You want to reduce chemical insults from other types of chemicals, and you want to reduce infection. You want to reduce pain because of the vasoconstriction. And we're big on nutrition and even topical nutrition. You need to have good nutrition to help wounds heal. Okay, for intraoral wound care, going back to dentistry now, what's lacking in standard therapy? Well, it's hard to put a Band-Aid in the mouth. So in dentistry, we haven't had many options. We basically, for example, we extract the tooth, we hand them a prescription for narcotic, pat them on the back, and wish them good luck. That's about it. We might have them rinse with one of these rinses, but you've already seen data showing I'm not sure how effective that is, except how effective is it killing our cells and off wound healing. But mechanical injury isn't really a big issue in the mouth because people are pretty protective. It's hard to bump into a table with your mouth, but people are pretty protective, so that's really not a big issue. But chemical insults, foods, drink, and, of course, biological, bioburden, that's a big issue. And we generally just send people off and they're just on their own in that really hostile environment of the mouth. And again, systemic narcotics aren't effective in reducing pain to the point where you don't have vasoconstriction as a factor. And then nutrition. Well, with our product, we tried to address all those. And, you know, I took that. Mechanical injury isn't really an issue. I mean, this gel really is. I mean, if you want to poke some, this gel is not going to protect mechanical injury. But again, in the mouth, people are pretty good about protecting. But it's very effective in forming a barrier between the injury and chemicals and pathological microbes. So it's very effective. Besides the data you saw on how effective is the preservative system works, it's very effective in reducing pain relief, and we can get a lot of people down to zero, and basically we hear they're down to 2, 1, 0, so they're getting way down below what they normally get with narcotic. And so that's going to help with the vasoconstriction. And again, the mannans are being ingested by the macrophages. The higher the mannan concentration, the faster the wound healing, and the less infection. So we've tried to address all these issues with our product, and this is what it looks like. It's in a syringe, and so the idea is that you can inject it right into the extraction site right at the time of surgery. And you do that, again, because remember bioburden, you need to address bioburden as quickly as possible. So they're still anesthetized. Pain isn't, I hope that's not grossing anybody out. I mean, I don't even think about that, but maybe somebody might. But that's right after the extraction. You put it right in immediately to address bioburden and to help dress the wound, and then you send it home with the patient. This is Barbie. This is actually Bill's daughter-in-law. She's an RN, and she works for my brother's oral surgery practice. He extracted her 4 impacted third molars, her 4 impacted wisdom. They were bony impacted. They were full bony impactions. Those are the ones that hurt the most and are more likely to develop post-op complications like dry socket. She used this product. Most people get 3 or 4 hours of relief before the pain starts to come back, before it washes away. She just used it every 2 hours. She didn't wait for the pain to come back. And that's another thing. This product is so safe to use. You don't have to wait like you do with narcotic. You can use this 10 times a minute if you want to. You don't need to. But you can use it anytime. She used it every 2 hours. She didn't need any narcotics. She didn't need any OTC med. This is all she used after those 4 impacted third molars. She healed up very nicely, healed up quickly, and she didn't have a pain issue. And that's the idea of this product, is it helps with the pain. It helps with the wound dressing. And in immediate dentures, instead of putting extraction site, just put it in the denture and put it in at the time of you deliver the denture at the time of extraction. Those patients get immediate relief, and that's what we did, and that's putting it in the mouth right after extraction. And that's really it, but that kind of gives you an idea, and all of our products we're developing are based on the same concepts of using nature, helping nature along, providing an environment to allow nature to do what it does best, and so all of our products are basically the same. We're using natural products. We don't have any synthetic man-made, you know, products. Like most products are. These are all products that are found in nature and are food, found in foods. So they're as safe as we can make them. And we've had this product out for 2 years. We haven't had any complaints. We haven't had any side effects or anything. We don't anticipate any, but somebody out there might have developed an allergy to something, but it's going to be a real rare occurrence with these particular ingredients. Mm-hmm. And so we've had really good results, and the oral surgeons love this product because their patients do, and dentists, but they love it because they love seeing the big reduction in their post-op complications, and their patients just come back looking so good and healing so nicely. And so that's the concept with these products, and that's where we are. But that's, you can see where we came up with the concept of producing these products, and that's where we are, and that's what we're always going to use for all of our products we develop. So there we are, David.
Well, John.
I hope that was okay. That was almost an hour and a half, so that's kind of a long presentation. But
we've gone longer than that, and I have to tell you this. We've gone like 2.5 hours before some people have, so you're well within time, but I have to tell you this. I'll tell you this, I mean, in most cases, people would have left, but I'm looking at the attendance, and no one left. In fact, we've had some more people join us during the webinar, so this has been a very, very absorbing, very, very interesting lecture. Uh-oh. I think you did something that brought the echo back.
I'm sorry. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, actually, but I think you did something that brought the echo back.
Try that.
Okay. Okay.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's better. Yeah. That's better.
Okay.
All right. All right. Well, thanks.
Having an echo, Bill. We have to have it that way. Bill was here, and anyway, he couldn't hear you talking, so he wanted to hear what you're saying, but it's not working well that way. So if there are any questions that anybody has, and Bill can certainly, he's in a better position to answer most of them than I am, except maybe some of the clinical things.
Okay. Tell you what, why don't I let me go to the website real quick and give him a number so if he can call in on his cell phone. Or you want Bill to be on the speaker instead, on your headset instead? I could give you a number to call in, but we probably wouldn't be able to hear him speak.
Yeah, that's the deal.
Yeah.
Well, just see what the questions are, and then if I need to hand this headset over to him, we'll let him deal with it and go from there.
Okay, sounds good. Sounds good. All right.
Yeah, okay. Or I could repeat it to him.
Okay, that'll work too. Folks, if you remember, if you're new here, there's a blue panel to the right of your screen, and there's a questions section, so you can actually type in questions. And I will be reading them out. We have already got some questions here. Oh, my goodness. Quite a lot already. All right. Okay.
We'll try to answer them to the best of our ability.
They were just waiting for you to stop to just throw out all the questions. Okay. First of all, I wanted to say again thank you. Also, thank you for mentioning Winston Churchill, who happens to be my favorite hero outside of the Bible.
Okay.
I have to have his book in front of me right next to my computer reading it. Some of the things you mentioned, like talking about how wounds some of the dentists who have used the sockets, the product, have come back and say that the wounds look like they've been healing for weeks when it's just days. I have to tell you that that sounds like science. That would have sounded like science fiction to me, but I actually got some of those syringes with a socket in it, and I gave them to a friend whose grandson had a major football injury, and he had a major cut in his upper lip, and so mm-hmm. I gave them to her to give to him to use, and just as like 1.5 weeks later, I never really saw the original injury, but seeing him again, the wound was, I was amazed. The wound was totally healed. It was almost like he hadn't had an injury there in the first place, just a slight scar from it.
Well, and people are using it. I mean, we just asked the FDA for intraoral indications, so that's all we have. But people are certainly using them externally for all kinds of injuries, and we have pediatricians that are actually using the product treating babies with gingival stomatitis and teething babies. It works great for teething babies. I mean, it works really well. So I mean, it's very, very safe to do. And so it's been used for lots of different indications besides those that we specifically asked for.
Right. Well, people will always try and use it for something, one thing or the other. And it'll
well,
get
obviously, if it's safe to use in the mouth, it's safe pretty much to use anywhere.
Exactly.
It's, you know, I wouldn't put it in the eyes. It's going to burn in the eye, but it's not going to damage the eyes, but it would sting. So I wouldn't do that. But
right.
Other than that, it's safe to use anywhere.
That's good to know. Diabetes, that's always been an interesting part of mine because, of course, those have some of the most difficult wounds to treat.
Yeah.
But, again, you're dealing primarily with the mouth, so if you don't feel comfortable mm-hmm. answering that question, that's fine.
Well, I mean, of course, like I said, diabetics don't heal as quickly. Diabetes affects every cell of the body, of course. And one of the things that the original product that Bill developed, the Boomer Thermal Wound Gel, was very, very effective in diabetic ulcers and all that. So, you know, I mean, this product's going to help it's going to help the healing and speed the healing process for anybody with any condition. They're going to go slower probably because they have diabetes, but still, relatively speaking, it's certainly safe to use. And if they're talking about the sugar content, this isn't going to affect diabetics in a negative way at all. So,
because it isn't glucose.
No, it's not glucose.
Right.
And it's not going to be converted to glucose. So, again, it's a beta link. So it's not digested by our cells. The bacteria in our gut can break it down. But it's not going to adversely affect diabetics. It's just going to help diabetics to heal better.
Good, good. I play racquetball with a foot doctor, podiatrist, who was also the head of the Diabetic Association for several years in Oklahoma.
Right.
So he deals with major diabetic foot problems and
yes,
intractable conditions for the most part.
That's absolutely.
Okay, well, now I'm going to take care of this one real quick. Where can you get the product, folks? This has to be this has to be prescribed, right, by the dentist, correct?
Well, we sell directly to the dentist, and then the dentist uses it in the office, and then they just give it to the patient to use. So, I mean, they can either sell it and work it, but we sell directly to the dentist or physician. It's not on the market for the general public. It's not a prescription. It's not a prescription. It's a professional product, but we sell directly to them. With our other products, we'll have some other products that will be OTC on it, but this one is, we sell directly to the clinician.
Got it. Okay.
Now, I will say this. We have had people that have called us up, and they've run out or whatever, and you know, I mean, we'll sell them some, but I mean, it's not, we don't make a habit of that. We've done that two or three times for people who were desperate, you know, and so,
right.
But it's basically we sell it to the clinician.
Well, one of the things is this, because we have people calling in from around the world, like Australia, and I think this person is actually calling from, asking from Australia about this. So that's, it makes it a little bit more difficult for a dentist to prescribe something that he can.
Yeah, I know. We have some groups that are selling in New Zealand, and, you know, when you get into different countries, you know, your regulatory agencies, everything's different. This
right.
is regular. This product is regulated as a medical device because it doesn't have any active, you know, active ingredient to FDA means drug. Well, this doesn't have any drugs in it. Actually, every ingredient in this product is active because everything in this thing has something that has that specifically helps in wound healing.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a unique and a brilliant product. If I say so myself, I'm bragging on Bill, but it is. From in America, with U.S. FDA, it's regulated as a medical device because it's a hydrogel wound dressing, and technically it doesn't have the active ingredient, which means drug to FDA. In Australia, I know, so, you know, then there are other countries that this probably would end up being marketed as a drug. They recognize it as drug, and they're, you know, so it just depends on the country. So we are an ISO certified company, by the way. So I mean that is issues out of the way. We have a group in Canada that's marketing and all that. So I mean we are in other countries, but we're not actively marketing anywhere except right here in the United States. We have some distributors that want to distribute. So we have a group in New Zealand and one in Canada, and we have people calling us all the time. But we're basically United States right now.
Got it. Got it. Well, this certainly needs to go around the world. We'll try our best to help.
Well, it's going to eventually get there. It's nothing's easy, as you know.
Right.
Especially when you're dealing with regulatory agencies.
Right. Right. Well, Deborah asks, I do animal rehab and wound care. Can I get some product for my clinic?
Yeah, I mean, for the clinic, sure. Just you can go to our website or call our 800 number. If I'll just go ahead and give it out, it's 800-755. You know what? I need to look it up.
Okay.
Yeah, I was right. 800-755-0044.
0044. 755-0044. Okay.
Yeah, and they can order, and you know, we'll send it. I mean, to a clinic like that, we'll send it. I mean, we basically market to dentists, but we can market to healthcare professionals or whatever.
Great.
So certainly they can do that, and that would be a good thing to do. Call that 800 number. Clara or Katie or somebody will take care of it.
Got it. Okay. So on the website is McMurlin.com, right?
Uh-huh. McMurlinDental.com.
Got it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Folks, I'm going to type that in and send that to you, okay? So just in case you didn't catch the number the first time. Have you seen any improvement in periodontal bone loss with any natural products?
Well, we haven't done any study. We've already had reports from people. They're anecdotal reports, but we've had reports from people that they're seeing with just this product. They're using it like I use a toothpaste sometimes. And we've heard reports, we expect that, and we do want to do some perio studies, we just haven't done it yet. It takes a long time to get studies started and run and all that. We actually have had one report, as you, bisphosphonate and the bone problem with necrosis and jaws with bisphosphonates, which I'm sure you're aware of, but it's becoming a real big problem for the people that are on bisphosphonate there. We actually had one person call in and said they saw a bone regeneration with this product, but I shouldn't even say that we had one person say that, one clinician say that. That wouldn't shock me, but we haven't done any data. That's, and we haven't followed up on that. We have heard reports from other clinicians on perio with socket depth reduction and loss and not bleeding. And as far as bone regeneration and perio, I don't think I've heard anything specifically about that.
Well, I would think that if you take away the hindering factors, if you take away the bioburden and other things that are in the way, the body should be able to heal itself.
And you know that slide I showed you that I just found a few weeks ago with the bone morphogenic protein, that's one of the implications, is that it could help with bone regeneration strength. And we expect that it would, but we don't have any data to support that.
Got it.
So that's where we are right now.
Got it. I'd like to, okay, dentist, where can it be obtained? Okay, I've sent out the 1-800 number to you folks and the website address. So if you still need it, just email us and we'll give it to you. Can this product be used for skin grafting cases and on the abscess?
Well, you know, legally, all we can claim is intraoral use.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, like I said, people are using it all the time. Can it be safely? Yes, sure it can. And on that, sure it can. It can be used on abscess. I'd stick it on abscess right now. I mean, that's what it's for. But again, it's kind of interesting how it works. We could have asked for external use too, but we just designed this to go in the mouth. So we just asked FDA for intraoral indications. That's what they gave us. And so legally, all we could claim is intraoral. And they gave us all wounds and all injuries and all lesions of the mouth. So anything in the mouth they gave us. Obviously, again, if it's safe to use in the mouth, it's pretty much safe to use anywhere. And it has been used just about everywhere. But we can't legally make that claim. And we're pretty sticklers about trying to do the right thing and do it the right way.
That's good.
So, you know, I mean, you can certainly experiment with it any way you want to, and I wouldn't worry about it. I can't promise you what kind of results you're going to get, and I can't tell you to do that. Number one, I'm a dentist. I mean, I don't practice dentistry anymore, but even if I were practicing dentistry, I can't practice medicine, so I'm not going to tell you what to do for your wound on your arm or something like that. That's not my purview.
Right. Okay. A friend, let me start again. I would like to ask if Dr. Hall has had any experience with potassium iodide or any other forms of iodine that are non-toxic for oral or internal use.
No.
Okay.
Potassium iodide. No. You know, potassium iodide, I think they used to use that, or maybe still do for what is that fungal infection? Sporotrichosis, I think. Is that what they use on sporotrichosis? But no, I don't have any experience with it. Those things, obviously, that's extremely toxic to the cells. I mean, I wouldn't put anything like that on a wound or anything like that. That's just, you know, there are other products that they use on canker sores and maybe that's what they're thinking about. And people will say that they heal faster, but gosh, you're just burning the dickens out of those tissues. There's no reason to do that, as far as I'm concerned.
Especially
now that you've got an option. But
exactly,
I've never used those. Even when I practice, that I'm not going to use that kind of stuff. That's, you know, unless you just have to. I mean, if you've got somebody that's just bleeding, you've got to cauterize it or something. But to treat a wound like that, I would never do that.
Right.
Personally, you know, the thing is, and I usually tell people that, you know, the thing about these anesthetics and things, right now at this very minute somewhere in the Metroplex in Dallas-Fort Worth, some doctor is telling some patient with a wound, but be sure and use hydrogen peroxide on this wound a couple of times a day. And I just kind of wish I could be there with a baseball bat. I wouldn't hit him over the head with it. I wouldn't even hit him with it, but I'd get their attention. He'd maybe tap it on the table or something. Dad, got it. You know, that we've known for decades not to do that. You don't treat wounds with hydrogen peroxide. You don't treat it with iodine. You don't treat it with gasoline and alcohol. You don't treat it with that stuff. All you're doing is you're causing infection. You're hurting.
Right.
You're slowing the healing process down. You're going to have more infections. If nothing else, just keep it moist.
Right.
And you're going to have fewer infections, going to heal faster, but a doctor is going to do it, but don't do it. There's no reason to do that. There's no reason for a doctor to be telling people that. But they do, because they don't study wound care. It's just they do it the way they've always done it.
Right.
But don't do that, and don't let a doctor tell you to do that.
So right.
If you need to wash a wound, if you feel like go to the drugstore and go to the contact lens solution. Go contact lens and get a contact lens solution. That's the saline solution, and use that. That's been shown. Saline has been shown to be as good as anything in cleaning wounds and not doing any damage. But you don't even really need to do that usually.
Especially when you have a product.
Just keep them moist, and if you've got something like our products that do a little bit more, do a lot more than just keeping them moist, then you're out of the game.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to thank you, especially the fact that you first of all started with how the body works, and you laid a solid foundation for us to understand how these other products work, and of course the dangers with the traditional medications and what was going on. I mean the risks as well as the promise of the traditional medications. But I think you just did a masterful job of putting everything in perspective, and
thank you. And, we're not anti, like I said, Shane, his son just got through med school. We're not anti-allopathy medicine. Oh, I believe in medicine and all that. But there are still some things that, we're always learning.
Right.
And there are some things that we just don't do right. And there are better ways to do things. And I'm not trying to talk down anybody because, we all do things that we are making mistakes, and we'll learn tomorrow that we should have done that. But. So I'm not bad-mouthing medicine at all. It's just that there are better. We're trying to make things better than they are right now.
Right.
And that's what we're trying to do. We're not trying to bash anybody at all. In this dentistry, we haven't had that many options. It's hard to do things in the mouth that you can do on the skin for obvious reasons. So, but we've tried to come up with a means by which some of these things could be addressed in a safe and effective way.
And that's great.
So that's where we're coming from.
That's just great. In a second, we'll probably ask Dr. McNally to give a preview of what he's going to be talking about in the upcoming 2 weeks. But I just want to say again, thank you, John.
You bet.
And folks, if you would like to get a copy of this recording, the handouts, the notes, the video, DVDs, you can get it on our website. In addition, don't forget, we sent out emails talking about a new membership program where for a very, very low price, at a very low cost, you can actually have access to all the webinars that are done in the past 30 days, for instance, and you won't have to miss these webinars at all if for any reason you're not able to attend live. So we've tried to make it as easy and as convenient for you to take advantage of this, of all these wonderful presentations that are being done on a weekly basis. For the month of July, we're going to be having at least two a week, and that's huge. And we're looking at health from several different perspectives. So be sure to check our websites to find out more about it. Dr. Bill, are you there?
Just a minute, Dave. Okay.
Okay.
Hello, David. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, sir. How are you?
I'm just great.
Well,
so I understand.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I understand in a couple of weeks I'll be talking about our new Allo book.
Absolutely. I have to tell you, you got to bring your A game, right, Bill?
Well, I've spent 30 years, studying Allo. First, we identified the active ingredient. I'm going to tell that story. And what I'm proud to be able to write about Yellow, with more than 300 PubMed, you know, peer-reviewed articles written by major universities all over the world, have supported our basic work. And we'll talk about wound healing. We'll talk about all of the effects that have been attributed to aloe. And the title of the book is The Science Behind Aloe, the Healing Plant. And just so you'll know, we have received approval for all topical wounds for essentially the same gel.
Really?
And the reason that we just now have done that is FDA is divided into divisions. So only the topical dermal group can give approval for topical wounds because that's treated by physicians. But wounds treated by dentists go through a whole different branch of FDA. So you have to put the submission together the way they want it with all the data and support and file it. And we did that. We got the oral report and our oral approval. And we have just recently gotten topical approval. So we expect to come out with a topical product in the near future. But the science behind all these products, you know, is written in this book.
Well, I tell you, we can't wait to actually hear from you. I mean, you're the one who discovered this active ingredient in the first place. And I have to say this, that I probably never mentioned this to you, and I'm going to repeat it again next week when you're on. But really, what we're doing with these webinars, it traces back to your discovery with the aloe, really. This would not have been possible without what you did. And I'll probably explain that some more. But I tell you, I mean, just from what you have been able to discover about nature and how the human body works and how to work intelligently with the human body, that has made a huge, huge impression on me and, of course, many people around the world. So we are really privileged and honored to have you come do a series of presentations for us.
Well, it's my privilege to be invited, and I look forward to my next talk.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Well, that does it, folks. You're in for a treat this month, and be sure to log in next week, and of course on Thursday too for the immune system modulation lecture that Dr. Zenk is going to give. All right. We'll let you go, and thank you again for staying this long, and you have a good night and a great week. God bless. Bye.